This video is going to cover the book, A Mind for Numbers, How to Excel at Math and Science. And although the title is very specific, the learning techniques in this book can apply to many different subjects, all the way to games like chess. Now, whether you're in high school struggling with math and science, or you're in college studying math, science, or engineering and doing well, the techniques taught here can apply to anyone, because learning itself is a science. And there are practices to improve efficiency and performance no matter what level you're at. So let's get started. Now, there are two modes of thinking you need to be aware of: focused mode and diffuse mode. Focused mode is obvious. It's when you are highly focused on something, like attempting a difficult math problem with no distractions. Diffuse mode is what happens when you're more relaxed and let your mind wander. Basically, just like taking a break. But what this does is allows different parts of your brain to connect and solve problems kind of in the background, and I will elaborate on this soon. But both of these are actually essential for deep learning and understanding when it comes to especially math and science. Now, to explain the significance of diffuse learning, I want to introduce something called the Einstellung effect. This is where you have an already formed idea in your head of how to solve a problem, which prevents you from finding a better solution. You're kind of zoomed into one idea. I've tutored personally a lot in math and have seen this all the time. For high schoolers, here's a common one. We'll be learning the quadratic formula, and I'll give them multiple problems that require it. Then I'll give them something like this, which they have done before. And they go straight for the quadratic formula, forgetting that they can just take out an x and it's already factored. They were zoomed into one idea, and it prevented them from finding a better way to do the problem. This has also been shown in chess players. Sometimes players have an idea in their head of what move they should do. They try to continue to scan the board for better moves, however, through studies of their eyes, they've shown that their focus stays on the original move they thought of, making it more difficult to come up with a better one. And this is where diffuse mode thinking comes in. It allows your brain to relax and the neurons to connect and kind of work in the background, which allows you to see more of the big picture. In the book, the author shows a picture of a chess grandmaster during a game who gets up from his seat and looks away from his game. He takes a short amount of time to distract himself and let his mind wander so he doesn't become stuck in a narrow way of thinking. And this is what diffuse mode thinking really does. You just take a break from that intense focus. Then when you come back to the problem, you have a fresh mindset, and often the solution, or a better solution, comes to you much faster. A very famous French mathematician, Henri Poincaré, struggled to crack a difficult problem, so he decided to take a vacation. And when he was getting on a bus, the answer suddenly came to him from a part of his brain that continued to work on the problem in the background. And you'll hear of many stories where this kind of thing happens. So this is the foundation for improving your skills. You need to alternate between focus mode learning and diffuse mode. No, you cannot just let your mind wander and wait for the answers to come. You need to focus intensely on a problem, then when you are stuck, take a break for maybe 2 minutes, maybe an hour, and then come back and focus again, and the solution may come to you much quicker as you have a fresh look at the problem. It may not just happen like it did for this mathematician, but resume the problem and it may surface faster than you think. Ways to get into diffuse mode include going to the gym, going for a walk, going for a drive, taking a shower, sleeping, and much more. And remember, you can't just look at a problem you have no clue what to do on and then take a break and think you'll get to the solution. You have to be logical. You need to actually understand the basics, then focus on the problem, and then alternate between that focused and diffuse mode thinking. Now let's get into some more specific study techniques and tips. When it comes to learning math and science, learning fast is like trying to gain muscle fast. It'll just burn you out. Although you can maybe memorize things very quickly, you can't learn on a deep level in one or two nights. So that's why you need to learn a little every day, or at least as much as possible. Now, the best study method they found for any topic is attempting to recall the material that you have just learned. What you don't want to do is reread material until you get it. This is one of the worst ways to memorize or learn new material. What you want to do is read something new, then turn away or close the book and try to recall what you just read as much as possible. Then read it over again and repeat that one more time. They found just with two repetitions, this worked better than nearly any other method done in the same amount of time. But okay, what about when it comes to doing problems like in math, physics, engineering, etc., which aren't just memorizing things? Again, here's what you don't want to do, and this I thought was very insightful because I know it will apply to a lot of people watching. What you don't want to do is attempt a problem, then when you don't understand it, you look at the solution and say, "Oh, I see how they got that," and then move on. This is one of the biggest illusions of learning math and science out there, so you should not fall for it. You haven't learned the concept even though you think you may have. If you need to look at the solution, that's no problem, but then you need to do a totally different problem on that topic and solve it completely on your own. So if you are struggling to learn a new concept, what you want to do is first read about the topic and make sure you understand the fundamentals. Ask your professor, your friends, or whatever it takes so you can just get the basics. You don't just want to dive into problems without learning the fundamentals. Then what you want to do is work a problem all the way through. Try to have the solution available, but don't look at it unless you really need to. Then, if you didn't fully understand the problem, you need to repeat it all on your own. And make sure as you're going through each step, you understand why it's being done, not just how it's done. This allows your brain to make connections rather than just reading the solution and thinking you have it. Then you want to take a small break after a few problems. Go into that diffuse mode thinking so you can come back with a fresh mind. And if you don't get something, you need to practice it a lot. That's basically what this all comes down to. It will take time, but your brain is going to keep making connections, especially as you accomplish problems on your own. Now, many students, on the other hand, will do a certain math problem correctly, but then right after that, they'll do more of those same problems. Now, this can be a good thing and improve test scores for sure, but this doesn't maximize your time in the most efficient way. If you want to learn the most in the shortest amount of time, then once you successfully learn a concept and do maybe a couple problems correctly, move on. If you had all the time in the world, then of course practice as much as you can. But often that's not the case, so this is something to keep in mind. And another tip which I really thought was interesting was to mix up the sections of the book you're doing problems in. Like, let's say your homework is in section 5.4 of the book. We'll do some of those problems, then do some from 5.3, then go back to 5.4, then maybe go back to 5.2. Especially if you're struggling, you'll need this practice. Now, why do you do this? Because you want to make sure that you could do all these problems on a test if you didn't know what section things were on. If section 5.4 is all about synthetic division, even if you get an abstract problem, you still can assume it requires synthetic division. But just given that problem randomly on a test, would you know to do that? This is something to ask yourself and a reason to kind of mix up the sections you work on so that you can fit the pieces together. Now, in another video, I talked about procrastination, but this book had a few takes on it as well, and I wanted to offer some more advice for those who have issues with procrastination. One thing to try is the Pomodoro technique, which there are many videos on, but essentially to sum it up, set a timer for something like 25 minutes, maybe a little less or more, but then solely focus on work for that time. This is short enough where anyone can really focus for that long. Then afterwards, reward yourself with some internet surfing or texting or whatever, but not for too long, maybe just a few minutes, and then repeat the process. Some people argue that they feel rushed with a timer in the background when doing something like math, but studies have shown that this actually helps because it will make you become accustomed to being on the clock and feeling a little stressed, so that when you're taking a test and that stress occurs, you're able to perform better. Also, you want to make sure you focus on the process, not the product. As in, you should care more about the time you're putting in, not how much you're getting done. It doesn't matter if it takes 2 or 5 hours to complete your homework, assuming you have the time. You really want to make sure you understand the material on a deeper level and learn how to apply it. Another very effective tool is to do the most important and disliked jobs in the morning when you get up, or maybe immediately when you get back from school. This then gives you that momentum to keep going. Another thing to try is mental contrasting, where you basically picture where you want to be compared to now and why you are doing this. One student from the book was quoted saying that he put what his starting salary would most likely be on his wall and framed it to remind himself why he's doing all this work, and it helped him with procrastination. And I'm going to stop there with procrastination. Now, when it comes to getting better at math or science, it basically all comes down to patient persistence. After so much time of doing all these techniques, it will reshape your brain and optimize the way you learn and solve problems. Persistence is often more important than intelligence. This author said that she absolutely hated math all throughout high school and failed her way through. She started studying just basic trigonometry when she was 26 years old after being in the military. But she had a shift in her mindset and decided that she was going to get good at math. She ended up getting a bachelor's in electrical engineering, a master's in electrical and computer engineering, then a doctorate in systems engineering with a background in various subjects. And she said that it got easier for her over time because of how she was learning to learn. And remember, things typically get more fun when you're better at them. People often are bad at something, then because of that they get bored, which makes them not try, and it's just a downward spiral from there. And throughout the book, she talks about many success stories or people who weren't naturally gifted at math who then excelled later in life. Just a simple shift in your mindset can do more than you may think. I'll end this video on one of my favorite stories of the 4-minute mile. The 4-minute mile was assumed by experts to be impossible for the human body. In over 100 years of the timed mile, no one had done it. Until one day in 1954, one person finally beat it by less than a second. But then less than 2 months later, another person beat it. And since then, thousands of people have beat it, including a few high school kids. And people say it was that switch in the mindset of others that the impossible was actually possible that then allowed the other people to beat the time more and more. So yes, your mindset is more powerful than you may think. Math is something I personally like a lot, but I still learned plenty and found lots of helpful techniques and tips from this book, which I've linked below if you want to buy it for yourself and support the channel. I hope this summary helped you. If you liked the video, don't forget to comment, like, and subscribe, and I'll see you all next time.